Let's say the first thing I need to, of course, I need to share is the Azure Active Directory. First of all, in an easy way, if I could try to explain, is a summarized version of the Active Directory. Of course, summarized because there are loads of things. Loads of things are not available, like OUs are not available, LDAP queries are not available, NTLM authentication is not available. We can't join, let's say, Windows 7 computers straight to the Azure Active Directory, and so on. And yeah, basically, it's a summarized version for directory services. And then, as you guys can see, a couple of arrows around, everything runs around the Azure Active Directory. Like, for example, the Office 365, of course, Exchange, SharePoint, Skype for Business, all the applications, they will use the users and passwords from the Azure AD. If you guys have planned, or if you are already using the Azure apps, there are, of course, thousands of apps in these days. Of course, you can basically make them to use the Azure to get the users and passwords from Azure AD. And here, if you look from the, here from the top, and of course, we can have multiple Azure subscriptions basically linked to the same Azure AD. And just before I go any further, I, you know, we have the opportunity to meet lots of people from different backgrounds, different companies, and some of them, they are still a little bit lost regarding the Azure Active Directory and the Office 365, because they might be using Office 365 for a while, and then they think they are doing the user replication to Office 365. And then eventually, when they come here to start to learn Azure, because they have planned to start, you know, Azure infrastructure, and then sometimes the question I get is like, okay, I have my users already on Office 365. Now I'm learning here how to synchronize users, my local users, to Azure, and then I will end up having, let's say, two places with the synchronization. And of course, that's, you know, is a kind of misunderstanding, because Office 365 doesn't manage any users, groups, or passwords. Everything is already on Azure Active Directory. And then those guys, they don't know, but they are already using Azure AD. Anyway, let's go ahead. Okay, guys, this is a very key, simple picture. Basically, when you are planning to have your Azure Active Directory, we have basically three main models. Okay, the first one is a simple Azure AD, where, as you can see, there is zero local Active Directory synchronization. And then if I just go further here, just one second. Yeah, basically, guys, the idea is to have don't have any local domain controller, or to have no Active Directory synchronization with Azure AD. To be honest, just to share with you, last year, probably it doesn't matter. I think it was in October. I had my first student with a kind of small network around 40, 50 computers only, and saying, yeah, Jackson, I don't have any local domain controller anymore. I have all Windows 10. And then I decided to join all my Windows 10 straight to Azure AD. And yeah, I don't waste my time, or I don't want to have local domain controller anymore. I'm using only Azure AD, and I don't have any domain controller on Azure. It was kind of, you know, the first student I met with that topology. Of course, because he's not using the Azure AD domain service, I will explain that later to you, basically he's losing a lot. You know, he doesn't have OUs, he doesn't have, for example, grow policy, and then every time when he needs to set up something on those 40, 50 computers, yeah, he kind of need to go computer by computer to set up the configuration. The solution for that in these days would be to use Intune. Okay, Intune is the Microsoft strategy now to manage mobile devices in a topology like that, only with Azure AD, not domain controller anymore. That could be the solution. As you can see there, it doesn't support Windows 7 computer join. Windows 10 is fine. It doesn't support grow policy, and kind of, you know, is not a full solution for the moment. We need to talk about other bits and pieces later. The next option is the second one here, is basically to have Azure AD and to have a synchronization. Years ago, when I started back in 2012, it was DirSync, and then eventually now became Azure AD Connect. And then the idea is to synchronize users, groups, and contacts to Office 365. Sorry, to Azure. Okay, and guys, to be honest, for a small, medium-sized companies, this is what everybody basically is using. Okay, why? First of all, because it's very simple. Okay, basically, as you can see here, we have our kind of domain controller with all users, groups, password, and stuff. And then the only thing you guys need to do is to, of course, there is a bit of configuration, but in a kind of summarized way, it's just a matter to download the Azure AD Connect, and then you need to decide what you need to sync. If you go to a basic configuration, that means a couple of nexts and finish, you will synchronize all the users. If you have 100 or 2,000, everybody will basically end up here on Azure AD. And then the idea, yeah, there you go. If there is a new employee now about to start, you would create that new employee on the local AD. The Azure AD, of course, keeps checking what's new. Anything new will synchronize to Azure AD. And then in kind of a few seconds, on the worst case scenario, a few minutes later, we can decide, let's say, and then we can assign permissions for that guy on Office 365, and that user would be able to connect any thing available on Azure or Office 365. Guys, the default configuration is to synchronize everything, but we can do filtering, and then eventually, if you don't, whatever are the reasons, if you don't want to synchronize everybody, we can synchronize all users from a particular OU, or we can synchronize users based on a group membership, or we can do synchronization based on attributes. I could say, oh yeah, anybody, if the city is like, I don't know, Dublin, okay, and then I want to do the synchron, I want to synchronize. If the location is London or is São Paulo or is New York, and then we don't want to do that. Guys, now let's say a very important kind of picture for you to understand is this little thing here. Okay, is the kind of sorry, I just keep getting lost here with my guys. This thing here called same sign-on. Okay, in a few seconds, I will explain about the federation service. That is a kind of the full single sign-on, but with a synchronized identity, we can get something called same sign-on. Just before talk about that, guys, as you can see, as I already said, the configuration is pretty much very simple. You might need a new VM. Of course, if you want, years ago, it was not possible to install Azure AD or DirSync when I started. It was not possible to install on top of a domain controller. In these days, it's fine. And then if you want to kind of save resources, you could install in one of your domain controllers. Yeah, here is a bit of catch, guys. I put it in kind of on my own words, two places for user management. And then there is a bit of asterisk there. Okay, it means when the users are synchronized to Office 365, let's say the properties like description, last name, first name, email address, and kind of things like that, they all come from the local domain controller. And then basically, when the synchronization is done, and you go to the Azure AD to do the kind of user management, it's not possible to change, for example, description. It's not possible to change, I don't know, let's say department. It means on Azure AD, those properties, they are like read-only. If you want to update, I don't know, somebody has moved department, yeah, you need to go back to your local domain controller, make the change on the local user, and then wait for the synchronization. For the attributes that are not in conflict, for example, if you are using Office 365, of course, when the user is up and all synchronized on Azure AD, you can go there and assign Office 365 licenses like Exchange and SharePoint and so on. And then it means for the properties that are not in conflict with your local domain controller, and then the master copy is on Azure AD. And then it means to assign a Office 365 licensing, and then you need to go to the Office 365 portal and do the configuration from there. But anything that is in conflict, like phone number and description and things like that, and then basically your local domain controller is the master copy for that. And guys, of course, don't need to tell you the last bit here. In order to have everything up and running, of course, we expect the synchronization to be kind of always working. Years ago, basically, it used to work in a synchronization every 30 minutes. No, 3 hours. So, sorry, yeah. When I started, the full synchronization used to happen every 3 hours, and now it's down for 15 minutes. Of course, guys, there is something called urgent replication and non-urgent replication. For example, if somebody changes a password in the local domain controller, because of course, password is a very important thing, that thing replicates pretty much straight away. Straight away, I mean, could be a couple of seconds or, maybe let's say 1 or 2 minutes. It's kind of, straightforward. If, for example, I use, I don't know, somebody is, the account is disabled, yeah, that's a kind of urgent replication as well. It will replicate pretty much straight away with, that couple of seconds or 1 or 2 minutes gap. But when you change something that's not really relevant for security, for example, you might update a phone number, that's not a big deal. And then that thing works in a cycles of 15 minutes, every 15 minutes. If, of course, whatever are the reasons, if you want to force a replication, there is a PowerShell command. You can do that if you want to force a replication. Okay, guys, hope everything is fine. You guys are happy so far. Okay, now let me explain this very important key picture. Sorry for the design. I'm not a very kind of PowerPoint good guy here. But anyway, let me explain. And guys, now this is the takeaway. Okay. Oops, sorry. Just forgot to select here. Okay. Okay. Good stuff, guys. Basically, now let me explain the same sign-on. Okay. And later on, I will explain the full single sign-on. Okay, that's the picture. We have here a couple of domain controllers with users, groups, and everything. Here I have a second virtual machine or physical box running my Azure AD. Then basically, the Azure AD goes to the domain controller, gets the users, passwords, and stuff, save in the local database, and then eventually that thing is replicated to Office 365. Okay, then let's say, guys, we got somebody new, a user called Anna, and we made a configuration. She now is all synced to Office 365. Okay, now we gave this new laptop for Anna, and she's about to kind of start a new profile. Of course, first time in the morning, she probably will log on to our Active Directory. Okay, all good, no problem. And then eventually now she starts using the Azure or Office 365 apps. Okay, for example, first time she launches Outlook. Outlook will request, oh yeah, username and password. She types username and password and click on the button to save the password. Okay, that's done. Then she goes to, I don't know, Skype for Business, save the password. She goes to Exchange, SharePoint, save the password. Other bits and pieces running from Azure. Okay, the good thing is, good and bad thing is, for the moment, all the passwords are saved locally on her computer. And then from the afternoon or whatever are the days now she's working, it gives the impression to her is a single sign-on, because basically in the morning she connects to the domain controller, and then when she launches Office 365, sorry, when she launches Outlook, the auto logon. She goes back to, I don't know, SharePoint, auto logon. She goes back to Skype for Business, auto logon. And then, I don't know, for the next 45 days, everything is perfect and she doesn't need to type any password, any credentials anymore. Okay, and then she's, a happy user. Okay, fair enough. And then 45 days later, the local domain controller password policy requests everybody to update the passwords. The guys now are changing passwords, including that user. The password now, the new password is replicated to Office 365, sorry, to Azure AD, and now we got our first problem. Of course, this user next morning when she come back or after lunch or it doesn't matter, when she comes back, Try to launch Outlook or SharePoint or Skype for Business or anything that runs from Azure or Office 365. And then basically she needs to type the new password. And then, of course, for a big organization, that could be a big headache for all the support guys to try to explain, oh, yeah, now you need to type your new password instead of the old password. It means, yeah, there you go. That's pretty much the story. The same sign-on works like that. Is same because basically there is a password on the local domain controller in Azure AD that is the same. And that password is saved on the local user profile. And then eventually every, let's say if the company requests everybody to update the passwords, yeah, every, I don't know, 30 days, 40 days, 60 days is a headache for everybody. Okay. To be honest, guys, I don't want to hide anything. Basically, my organization here, New Horizons in Dublin, we don't have thousands of users. And to keep the story kind of simple, years ago I had a discussion with my director, and then eventually we decided to keep simple. And this is exactly okay what I've been using since 2013 when I migrated things to Office 365. Okay, that's the story behind the synchronized identity with Azure AD. There are some bits and pieces here. I'm not going to read everything, and I will send my presentation to you later on. But when it comes to do the configuration, if you go to a kind of single Active Directory forest, it's pretty much straightforward. It's next, 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 and especially if you want to synchronize everything, it's pretty much a couple of nexts and finish, and then job done. It's pretty much very simple. Yeah, from the Azure AD, these are pretty much the components after the Azure AD installation. Okay, don't expect to go and see only kind of single component. As you can see, the Visual C++ and bits of SQL Server and other bits and pieces. But again, it's not a big deal. Everything's automatically. Of course, if you're talking about thousands and thousands and thousands, I think is kind of above 500,000 users, and then we might need to go to a full SQL Server instead to use the SQL Server Express. But most of the customers will be fine. Okay, now let's say, guys, if you are not happy with what I told you so far regarding, the same sign-on, it means every couple of, I don't know, maybe a month, every couple of weeks, the employees might get lost regarding the passwords. And then, of course, the ultimate solution is to go for the last one, that is the full federated service using Azure AD and the Active Directory Federation Service. I wouldn't say very, but complex enough to do the installation. And guys, I'm kind of very happy. Last year, at some stage, Microsoft released these two new features on Azure AD, okay, the pass-through authentication and the seamless single sign-on. Very nice, very simple. I will take you through those two things more kind of at the end of my presentation. But I'm really excited because initially we had, let's say, these three things. As I said, very simple configuration using the Azure AD only. Second option, kind of, for most of the customers, it's fine, especially for small, medium-sized companies doing the same sign-on. And then, guys, it was a kind of big jump for the federated service, which I will explain now in a few seconds. And then, there was something missing between the Azure AD Connect and the federated. And eventually, now we got it. Now, I mean, I think it was kind of already 1 year old. But at some stage last year, then eventually you got these two new features called pass-through authentication and so on. But I will take you in a few seconds to talk about that. Okay, guys, now, yeah, there you go. Let's talk about that third authentication option. Okay, that is the federated identity. As you can see here in the picture, okay, we still have the local domain controller, okay, running here. We still need to have the Azure AD. Okay, and then the Azure AD Connect, sorry. And then we have the Azure AD. And then, guys, yeah, here is kind of the complex part now. We need to have infrastructure for the Active Directory Federation Service. Okay. The advantage is a couple of them. Yeah, there you go. Guys, I will show you in 2 seconds. Full single sign-on. basically, you know, the user come in the morning, the user type, you know, the credentials, and if the user is working from kind of on-prem, pretty much everything should be single sign-on. And whatever 30 days, 60 days, whatever the user needs to update the password is not going to cause any problem for the end user, where the end user should kind of retype the new password. No, that's kind of, you know, is out of the way. Guys, why? Because all the authentication happens from the local domain controller. Okay, I have a better picture I will share with you in 2 seconds. But the idea is when you are about to log on, I don't know, to authenticate anything on Office 365 or Azure, basically we remove the authority from Azure AD to do the authentication. And Azure AD must go somehow, I will show you in a few seconds, must go and talk to your domain controller in order to have the credentials. And then it means for companies, you know, if the company is looking to have, or maybe they have already, a heavy audit, you know, to track who is logging on, who is logging off, and things like that. And then, yeah, there you go. They don't need to change anything if they are moving to Azure, because we are forcing Azure AD to talk to the domain controller, okay, in order to do that. And, you know, other bits and pieces. Regarding passwords, it's up to you, okay, if you want to synchronize passwords or not. Initially, we don't need to synchronize password. The only thing is, if you have the password synchronization and something happens on your local kind of, you know, domain controllers, and then you could easily switch between federated service to synchronized Azure AD without synchronizing the password, because the passwords are already there. All the bits and pieces I will explain in a few seconds. Guys, the only kind of, you know, couple of problem is, yeah, much more complex. And then usually when I'm teaching here, you know, the guys who come to do Office 365 or Azure, and then after the explanation I will give you in a few seconds, they say, oh, thanks very much. That's for the environment I'm working at the moment, is far away too much. But anyway, let's say in a few seconds. Yeah, definitely, we need a couple of more servers. We need a full, you know, Active Directory Federation service installed, and a couple of other things. Yeah, anyway, let's go straight to business. Guys, this is the picture you need to understand. Okay, we still have here, 1 second. Yeah, we still have here the domain controller, okay, on-prem with full users, groups, and passwords and stuff. And then, yeah, same story, we have the Azure AD to do the synchronization from the local domain controller to Azure AD. Of course, guys, when you are doing the synchronization, as I said, you don't need to synchronize passwords, because some kind of, you know, companies, they might be a bit of afraid, or whatever the compliance they are following, they don't want to synchronize any password out of kind of, you know, their on-prem. That's fine. Then, you know, we can synchronize users without a password. Okay, guys, now have a look here what exactly happens when somebody is looking to authenticate. Okay, anyway, let's say you have that user. Eventually, that user requests authentication. Let's keep simple for Outlook, okay, because she's using Outlook, Exchange Online. Okay, fair enough. The request basically goes to the Azure AD. And then because Azure AD now is not running anymore as a full kind of authority, authentication authority, Azure AD eventually requests back saying, okay, that's fair enough, but I need a token. Okay, I need a token that proves your name, your identity, and things like that. Okay, that thing comes back to the workstation. The workstation basically needs to talk to one of the ADFS servers. ADFS servers basically needs to talk to the domain controller. The domain controller issue the token, okay, and then eventually it goes back. The workstation presents the token to Azure AD, say, oh yeah, there you go, I'm Jackson, here's my credentials, I belong to those groups, and so on. And then eventually Azure with whatever are the Azure apps or Office 365 will do the authentication. Guys, there are two big or let's say three big things here, and that would be why some of the companies, they go for federation service. Okay, first of them, as I already told you, there is no need to synchronize passwords. And then for the companies, as I just said, where they are not happy to synchronize or to have any passwords out of their kind of on-prem, yeah, there you go, that's the solution. Guys, second option. Let me just go back to tell you a kind of quick story regarding this picture here. If we have a synchronized authentication, and let's pretend there is a big fight between one of the managers and one of the employees, and then the employees eventually runs out of the company and say, "What the crap, I don't want to work here anymore. Send me my P45 and I'm out." And the guy kind of, runs away from the company, physically from the company. And then that manager could say, "Oh my God, that guy's really angry. Okay, let me disable his account to make sure he doesn't go to Office 365 or Azure and mess up with anything." Okay, and then as I told you before, we need to do the account disable here. But, as you already know, there is a delay in order to have that synchronization eventually done on Azure. Of course, you can always force, but at least you are talking about a couple of seconds or a couple of minutes. That could be exactly the time needed for one of those angry employee to go there and eventually log on Office 365 and delete everything that would be possible based on his or her permissions. It means what I want to say is when we disable an account, there is a bit of delay in order for that thing to replicate to Office 365. Guys, that problem we don't have here. Because when the account is disabled, it's disabled straight away on the local domain controller. And then eventually when that user, try to log on back to any Office 365 resource, as I told you already, the Office 365 or Azure, they are not in kind of position to do the full authentication. And then what's happening is they need to talk to the domain controller anyway. And because the account is blocked or is disabled on the domain controller, it's kind of, zero delay when it comes to have an account that is disabled or enabled. Okay, that would be kind of, a big advantage from the security point of view. Guys, is a summarized version, of the topology. This is the second picture, and then there is a third and fourth picture. Guys, have a look here. What's happened when we have a user working, let's say, from home? Okay, we have this guy here working from home and about to, I don't know, connect anything on Office 365 on Azure. Okay, as you can follow the arrows here, the request goes to Azure. Azure say, "Oh yeah, that's fair enough, but I'm not, in a good position to do that." And then actually, guys, okay, let me give you a real example. Basically, when the user try to log on the mail.office365.com, basically that page is redirected to the ADFS proxy. And then, as you can see, guys, the ADFS proxy is running from your on-prem. Okay, you need to have a public IP, or you need to do the kind of, the proxy, the reverse proxy. Basically, that server must be reachable from outside. This guy, will talk to the internal ADFS server. The ADFS server will basically check the credentials to get the token from the Active Directory, and then eventually, everything goes back, and the user is able to log on. Okay. This is for a user who is running kind of, outside. If a user like this guy here, is working physically from the on-prem, and then of course the communication, thanks to a DNS configuration, the request goes to the local ADFS, and then get a token, and then eventually this guy, connects to the Azure and so on. Okay, guys, that's fair enough, but the problem is, the big headache, especially for small companies, will be the high availability. Because it means if eventually, let me just change the pen here, hopefully, guys, and then it means if eventually this server goes down, probably at this stage, I don't need to tell you, anybody out of the out of the company is not won't be able to use any Office 365 or Azure resource, okay, because they won't be able to get a ticket. For all the users running from the local company, in the local company is fine. If this guy here basically goes down, guys, and then that's gone. Nobody working from home or nobody working from on-prem is able to use anything, okay? Any app on Azure or any, let's say, Office 365, okay, application. Okay, that's kind of the second, okay? This is, let's say, first point of failure. This is the second one, Okay, this is the third one. Of course, if, I don't know, somehow the domain controllers are not reachable, yeah, nobody is able to use anything. And of course, the next one, don't need to tell you, would be the internet link. If the internet link is down and basically your company is not reachable anymore, or any of those ADFS servers or Azure, sorry, the local domain controller is not reachable, yeah, nobody can connect on Azure AD. And then the solution is, yeah, to have sort of high availability here, okay, high availability here, two or three domain controllers here, and of course we need at least, you know, two internet links to make sure all those four elements are, you know, 24/7 available in order to get troubles with the authentication. And guys, just to share my real life experience, this is exactly what's happened with me back in 2013. And then after having a chat with my director, we kind of, you know, came together with the same answer, let's say the same idea, saying that's far away, it's too much, it's too complex for a small company like us, okay, in order to leave the, you know, to keep the high availability. And again, in order to go to a federated service is not really related to the company size, but just to share my experience, let's say when I'm talking to different people here, it's pretty much related to the company size. Let's say I never seen, for all the people who I met already here, let's say a small company with, I don't know, 50 computers, 60 employees using federated service. Okay, usually, coincidence or not, all the people I met using ADFS, Federation Service, we are talking about hundreds at least, you know, I don't know, 400, 300, or again, not necessarily, but in general, this is what's happening. Guys, there is a second solution. Okay, if you think, now that's kind of, you know, it's too much and I really don't want to have the responsibility to have those four layers of high availability running on your prem, okay, the next solution is that. Okay, basic, of course, you need to do a cost assessment, but and then the idea is, why not to have a domain controller on Azure, okay, to have the ADFS servers on Azure, to have the ADFS proxy on Azure. Yeah, why not? We could have even, because if I have a domain controller on Azure, we could have even the AD Connect, okay, on Azure as well. And of course, the VPN gateway to connect my internal company. That's brilliant. And then it means, especially if my business basically has lots of guys working from home or working, you know, around the world, and mainly what they need is to get access to Office 365 stuff and to, you know, Azure apps and things like that. Yeah, that's can be a good configuration because it removes kind of the pressure from my shoulders to have my on-prem, you know, to have those four elements, internet link, ADFS server, proxy server, and domain controllers to have 24/7 on my on-prem. Because, you know, if the link here goes down, yeah, it's not a big deal because I still have everything on Azure. Okay, that's fine. Of course, you guys need to do a nice cost calculation because, for example, you know, in order to have a domain controller, let's say a basic configuration, 1.7 gig of RAM, 70 gigs of disk, one core is, last time when I checked, it was around 56 euros, okay, to have one box, okay, like that. And then, yeah, anyway, need to do a bit of cost assessment. But that could be a good idea, as I said, to kind of transfer the high availability to Azure instead of your own on-prem. Of course, the ultimate picture would be this one here. Okay, you know, that picture I didn't do myself. I just took from internet from Microsoft. But of course, you know, for an enterprise big enough company, that would be the ultimate configuration. Okay, thanks to a DNS configuration, it would go to a traffic manager. If you're not aware of Azure Traffic Manager, it means, let's say I have two data centers. Okay, this one here is in, let's say, Dublin. Okay, and this one here is somewhere in US. Yeah, and then it means if somebody is about to request an authentication around kind of, you know, EU, And then it means the traffic manager will forward the request to here. But if you are physically closer from US, maybe working from Mexico or Brazil or, you know, I don't know, let's say somewhere near US, and then the traffic manager will divert that communication to here. And then a load balancing to go to the ADFS proxy, and then a second load balancing, okay, to talk to one of those ADFS Active Directory, and then of course a communication to the local company as well. Yeah, oh, that would be the kind of the definitely the ultimate top class configuration on Azure regarding the whole single sign on. Let me see. I think that's it pretty much and for this first part. And then, guys, what I need to say is in order for you to decide whatever, okay, you want to do is, of course, later on you could always review my quick presentation here. But, yeah, you need to see how much money and how much complexity, okay, you want to have. Of course, that one sounds great, to have a full 100% single sign-on where you don't need to be worried when the users are updating passwords. But hopefully after my explanation now, things are a little bit, you know, clear how complex things can be. And then second option, much more simpler, but maybe not perfect from the single sign-on point of view, is the what pretty much everybody is doing from a small, medium-sized company, is the synchronized kind of, you know, synchronize identity. Okay, yeah, guys, that's it, let's say, pretty much from the first couple of slides, and I would say the key slides, okay, are those. Now, especially if you've never done anything on the Azure AD, let me quickly show you one thing here. Share window, okay, 1 second, let me just launch here. Okay, there we go. Guys, I forgot to tell you, if you look from your Skype for Business, okay, on the top corner, top right corner, there is a button if you want to make that thing fully screen. Sorry, I should tell you that 45 minutes ago. Okay. Okay, guys, if you are kind of new on Azure, yeah, there you go. This is my Azure, okay, portal. And then here on the left, as you can see, is the Azure Active Directory. Okay, basically, if I click there, this is the Azure Active Directory, or let me call the simple version. Okay, the full version I will talk about later. But for example, if you want to set up a new user on the cloud, yeah, that's pretty much simple enough. As you can see here, I have a bunch of users. The name can be a little bit tricky. If you look, guys, here on the... sorry, I think there is a small delay on the... to refresh the page. Okay. Or maybe it could be my laptop only. Okay, in a few seconds, you should see basically a list of users in groups and everything. And then when you check your Azure AD, of course, if you are using Azure AD Connect to do the synchronization, and then you always is easy enough to identify if the users are in cloud user or if the users are, you know, synchronized with Azure AD. Okay, guys, just a second. Sorry, could you just type for me? Did you manage to see my quick demo? Maybe it was too quick, because I have a second laptop here where I can get a kind of, you know, the experience you guys are using. And my laptop, I'm not sure if it hanged or something, you know, happened. Did you manage to see the user list I showed you, let's say, 2 minutes ago? If you could just type yes or no. Just want to, oh, okay, that's good. Okay, that's great, yeah, okay, that's better. Maybe it was just something wrong with my laptop. Okay, guys, let me do something. We are kind of, only 15 minutes to go. And let me just finish some key more slides to cover the theory. And then if times allow, I will run a second, okay, a quick demo. Okay, guys, now basically, there are a couple of things when we are talking about the Azure AD. Okay, as quickly, I already told you before, basically, Azure AD, okay, the kind of the basic version, doesn't support Grow Policy. It doesn't support LDAP. And as I kind of try to explain, is a, let's say, web authentication platform for apps on Office 365, Azure, and other things as well. But the thing is, what can be a little bit confused is there are loads of different versions. Okay, you can go for Azure AD, the free version. Okay, if you have Office 365 only, okay, you are using the free version. And then there is a basic version, okay, and then P1 and P2. Okay, the first one is free. And then, if you're not happy with that, I will show the differences. And then, of course, you can start paying, a little bit for whatever you are looking for. Okay, let's explore the thing. Okay, guys, a simple thing I want to share as well is, of course, when you are reading about the Azure SLA, okay, and depending, there is, a variation on that for storage, for Active Directory and bits and pieces. But if you never pay attention, basically, guys, here is the story, okay? Most of the service, they are, let's say, the 3.9s, okay? And then it means Microsoft is kind of, try to guarantee, or they can guarantee, the downtime will be maximum 8 hours and, a couple of minutes per, let's say, year. If you see anything regarding the 4.9s, and then it's only 52 minutes a year of downtime. And if you see, let's say, 5.9s, and that's brilliant, only 5 minutes and so on. Okay, anyway, guys, what I want to say is the free version, first of all, there is no SLA, okay? I never had that experience, but let's say you are using Office 365 and you never kind of, bother to check the Azure AD, and eventually you are using the Azure AD, the free version. Yeah, eventually if there is any big problem and eventually you can't, or you are not able to do any authentication or something is wrong, and then I'm afraid, if you call Microsoft, they could say, yeah, could be 2 hours, could be, I wouldn't say 2 days, but let's say they are not in under pressure to try to fix the problem. Of course, they will be to fix the problem. But what I want to say officially, there is no SLA, okay? Okay, it's free version. Guys, yeah, no problem at all. I did that, actually, if you want to implement a full single sign-on with the Federation service. Yeah, there is no problem at all. Yeah, that could be a limitation for big companies. Okay, maximum 500,000 users, okay, you can create or you could upload, those guys, and other kind of bits and pieces. There is no problem at all. We can have multi-factor authentication. It means, some companies for kind of best practices, all the enterprise admins, when they are doing anything on Office 365 or Azure, they need to do the multi-factor authentication. It means, username and password plus code on the mobile, or plus, they need to allow the authentication through a mobile app or from a phone call and things like that. Okay, this is a free version. Guys, if you are looking for the basic version, maybe it's too small here to read, but I'm talking about kind of 80 cents, okay, per month per user. And then what you can get on top of that is no object limitation. Okay, it could be 100,000, 1 million of technically. Okay, yeah, now that's good. There is a 3.9s of SLA. And if you want, you can do the what we call the company branding. It means when the user is about to log on Office 365 or Azure or anything, yeah, you could basically edit a page and, have something kind of nicer. And you could enable the password reset for users, like Facebook and Google and stuff. If somebody forgets a password, they could reset themselves. Okay, and then guys, if you go to the premium version, oh my goodness, as you can see, is a big jump, and a big jump on the price as well. Last time when I checked, it was like €5 per user per month, okay? Yeah, we have multi-factor authentication. We have much greater now reports from the Azure AD Connect Health. regarding, replication delays and, everything that's happening. We have the self-service password reset and something called password write back. And then it means if somebody forgets a password, that user is a synced user. Yeah, the user could reset a password from Office. Sorry, the user could reset a password in a web interface on Azure AD, and Azure AD will be able to basically synchronize a password back to the domain controller. Yeah, the last one here is interesting as well. Dynamic groups, basic dynamic groups. I can say, oh yeah, if the location of your user is Dublin, and then you automatically belongs to a group called Dublin user. If the location is New York, and then you belong to New York, just to get some permissions and stuff like that. Okay, this is the P1 thing. The next one is the P2. Okay, the price jumps again. Okay, now is 7 euros, kind of in a half. And then, guys, it's pretty much all related to security. Okay, we can enable some really cool things. There is a heavy machine learning, okay, running kind of behind your Azure AD to try to understand and to have a better picture of all the authentication activity. And then, for example, guys, the system can detect something like this, okay, impossible travel situation. For example, I don't know, 9 o'clock in the morning from Dublin, you logged on the Azure AD. And then half an hour later, there is a logon request from Australia. And then it means, come on, it's impossible. Guys, of course, we could have a VPN and stuff. But let's say you never, ever logged on from Australia. And then half an hour later, I don't know, 2, 3 hours later, there is a logon request from a public IP in Australia. And then, no, that's, definitely is a suspicious behavior. And then you can get an alert or can block and things like that. And guys, of course, based on the machine learning as well, Microsoft has a kind of heavy monitoring on all the suspicious public IPs, kind of the bad public IPs. And then if there is any kind of attempt to log in using your credentials from one of those kind of suspicious IP, and then you can set a bunch of configuration as well and monitor and things like that. Yeah, all the tests I've done and everything I read in the study is heavily sits on top of security. And then one more big decision. Yeah, this there are a couple of things we can set regarding what I said. Oh yeah, I want to request multi-factor authentication for all the users, or maybe at least for all the administrators. And then, yeah, that will be a little bit, expensive. Let's say if you think in a big scale, 7, 8 euros per user, but maybe you could enable those things only for the administrators and stuff. Yeah, guys, as you can see, yeah, just, have a couple of screenshots here, and I will share this screenshot with you, okay, later on. Okay, guys, I just a little bit worried with the time, okay? I just need to go through two key elements, okay, for today, and then that's it for now, for the moment. Okay, guys, as I told you at the beginning, the Azure AD is a kind of, summarized version of a directory service. Doesn't support OU, doesn't support computer join, doesn't support LDAP, doesn't support NTLM, and things like that. And then if you are looking to have those things available on your Azure topology, we have two scenarios, okay? The first scenario is basically, yeah, why not to have one or two domain controllers on Azure, okay? Guys, you need to remember, if you're not, maybe you read that already, you are aware or not, every time, let's say when you're talking about cost, okay, costing, every packet that goes into your Azure topology is free, okay? But packets going out, you pay. Okay, you pay for that. And then it means if you have a couple of virtual machines, a couple of applications running on Azure, and they need LDAP, they need Kerberos, they need, those things supported by a domain controller. Yeah, if you don't have a domain controller on your Azure topology, those applications need to come, through the VPN and talk to your local domain controller. And then every time when there is a communication, of course, Microsoft will charge for that. If it's not a big deal, I'm talking about a small scale, maybe, okay, that's fair enough, is fair enough, you know, for us to pay. But if you're talking about a couple of gigs or tera of communication, that's too much. And then the idea is, let's keep simple. Why not to have one or two domain controllers running as a virtual machine on Azure, and then all of those applications and VMs, now they can talk to your domain controller and kind of, you know, end of the story. Of course, the cons of that would be, of course, you need to pay for two virtual machines. You need to keep those virtual machines protected. You need to manage the hotfixes and service packs. And, you know, it's like on your shoulders, the responsibilities to keep these two things, those two DC3 and DC4 domain controllers, always up and running. And guys, back maybe 2 years ago or kind of 18 months ago, that was the option. Okay, to have a domain controller on Azure or not to have any domain controller in Azure, and we would increase the communication. And then eventually, at some stage, Microsoft came with this new guy here, Azure AD Domain Service. Please, guys, don't get confused, okay? Azure AD was everything I've been talking up to now. Every time when you see Azure AD Domain Service, how could I explain? This is basically as a plata is a platform as a service. Okay? As you can see here, when you install and of course pay for that, we can have just a second, let me get a pen here. Okay, and then we can have a full LDAP. Sorry, one second. Okay, we can have a full LDAP, we can have Azure, we can join computers to domain, we have domain controller, sorry, we have Kerberos, we have OUs, we have NTLM and everything. Guys, that would be the let's say the competitor, okay, of a domain controller. Instead of have a domain controller, we could have this guy here. I did loads of tests, and when you are doing the installation, guys, of course, you must connect that Azure AD domain service to one of your VNets, okay? And then based on the VNet you are plugging this component, you will have two IP addresses for the DNS server. And then all the you know computers or VMs running on Azure, of course you need or you should point the DNS server to whatever is the DNS server presented by the Azure domain service. Guys, there is a bit of catch. Okay, oh yeah, the SLA is kind of, you know, quite good. It's 99.9% of availability. The only kind of cup of catch is the following. First of all, it is not possible for you to add an additional domain controller to the Azure AD domain service. Okay, no. It's like, no, this is an isolated environment. Microsoft will manage the high availability, and you can't kind of, as I said, plug one of your domain controllers into this service. Okay, that's not possible. You have no access. I might have these things. Yeah, it's coming up later. Okay, you don't have access to the schema. Okay, eventually, if you need to edit the schema, make some change on the schema, that's not possible. And the main reason is because you are not enterprise administrator. Okay, you are the administrator for that domain, but you are not the enterprise administrator. Okay, the other thing lots of people get a little bit lost is, okay, that's fair enough. I have installed Azure AD domain service, but now, you know, how can I manage this thing? Where is the Active Directory users and computers? Where is the Active Directory sites and service and things like that? Basically, the way it works is you need to have on Azure a virtual machine, and then what you need to do is to have a server 2012 or 2016. I've basically implemented on server 2012. You need to install the Active Directory tools. Okay, and then when you have a member server that is joined to this domain, the only thing you need to do is go to the tools and go to the server manager, sorry, and install the tools. And then after installing the tools, yeah, there you go. And then basically you will have Grow Policy Management Console, you will have the Active Directory using computers, and basically things like that. And then guys, the way it works is like this. If you have an environment where you are not replicating your local domain controller, the way it works, just let me get a, hopefully get a pen here. Okay, the way it works is, yeah, from your Azure Active Directory, It will replicate the users to the Azure AD domain service. Then if you have already, I don't know, 100 users on your Azure AD, they will be replicated to the Azure AD domain service. All the users you create, yeah, please look at the error, okay? The error comes from the left to the right. Every time when you create a new user on Azure AD, it replicates to Azure AD domain service. But new users, if you create new users on the Azure AD domain service, they never replicate, okay, back to your Azure AD. And we have no control on that replication. Okay, basically, it works in a cycle of 20 minutes, and there is no way for us to change that schedule, at least up to now, and it's not possible for you to force the synchronization. If you have, guys, basically a local domain controller, and then, yeah, now, as you can see, the second picture is starting from the bottom. We have the Azure AD Connect that synchronizes users from your local domain controller into the Azure AD. And then the Azure AD users will be synchronized to Azure AD domain service. And then all the VMs and all the applications connected to the Azure AD domain service, they will be kind of, you know, benefit from there, and then kind of, you know, job done. I think, okay, yeah, okay, that's just a quick screenshot. Okay, guys, yeah, anyway, I will send you this presentation, okay, later on. Yeah, there you go. This is pretty much the limitation. Okay, I already told you, starting from the bottom. Okay, there is no way for you to kind of extend the schema. The replication is a not controlled replication. Okay, only 20, kind of every 25 minutes. When you add the service, basically the billing happens per hour, and there is no way to kind of pause the billing. You don't need to uninstall. You know, you are not enterprise administrator. And yeah, basically it's not yet a full domain controller. Okay, guys, is a domain running as a kind of, you know, platform as a service, but basically is the option today to fix the problems when we don't have a domain controller. Guys, I think you guys already saw this picture on my LinkedIn, I think last year, some stage in December, I think I uploaded. And that is pretty much, you know, sorry for the poor drawings, but that is pretty much only the full picture. Starting from the on-prem, we would have the users and groups and everybody, and then the Azure AD would do the synchronization to the Azure AD. Okay, that synchronization is basically controlled. Okay, you can change the schedule, you can force the synchronization, you can kind of decide who you want to synchronize and kind of, you know, things like that. And then all the Office 365, all the Azure applications, they will be able to take benefit from users and passwords and stuff, okay, from the Azure AD. And then eventually, if you install Azure AD domain service, basically, all of those users, and then there is no way to filter all of those users, they will show up in the Azure AD domain service. Last time when I checked the price, it was around up to 25,000 objects, okay, around 92 euros per month. Okay, and then again, you need to do a bit of assessment to see if it's better to have Azure AD domain service or maybe to have a full domain controller, okay, instead. Okay, that's pretty much the story behind the Azure AD, domain service. Okay, guys, and then, sorry, we are a little bit late. I just now to finish this presentation. Okay, maybe next time I need to book as a 1.5 hour. Guys, I think it's worth enough for you to stay with me for 5 or 10 more minutes, just for me to go through the Azure AD Connect, okay, pass-through authentication and seamless authentication. Okay, at some stage at the beginning, I told you there was a kind of big gap between the Federation service and the kind of basic Azure AD Connect. And now, thanks to the pass-through authentication, we got that back. Okay, let's go. Guys, this picture here, what actually is the pass-through authentication? The pass-through authentication, when you enable this thing, in order to enable, disable, you can do that from the wizard on the Azure AD Connect. Is basically all the authentication, okay, must be done from the local domain controller. Okay, if you look from the left to the right, basically when the user try to log on, the Azure AD will kind of act as a federated service. So, sorry, I'm not in charge to do the authentication. And then there is an agent you need to install in one of your domain controllers or in a couple of domain controllers. And then basically that agent is able to talk to the Azure AD, get the authentication request, talk to the domain controller, do the authentication, provide the token, and then feed back to the Azure AD in order to have the user able to log on. And then it means in this case, for all the users, for all the Azure AD synchronized users, every time when they want to log on, the authentication now occurs from the local domain controller. Okay, again, that guys, in a much simpler way, we can fix the problem I told you before. ADFS is too complex, but I want to make sure the user authentication is done by my local domain controller, because I don't know, for auditing reasons and other things. Guys, if you are worried regarding the high availability, no problem at all, very simple. What I need to do is basically just to install multiple agents. Okay, basically, you know, just install maybe three agents in three different computers and then you are sorted. That's it. I think I have a screenshot here at some stage. One second. Oh, there you go. Guys, look. If you go to the Azure AD Connect wizard, if you run the configuration wizard again, the only thing you need to do is to pick that option, pass-through authentication. Next, 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 finish. Wait for the full synchronization. In literally, I don't know, 5 minutes, you can have, okay, this picture implemented. Guys, of course, if eventually your domain controller is not reachable, maybe, you know, you have redundancy on the domain controllers, you have redundancy because you have installed a couple of agents, but your link went down and you have only a single internet link. Yeah, guys, don't need to tell you, any authentication request for Office 365 or any Azure app won't happen because, of course, your domain controller is unreachable. But if you have, let's say, two links, or, you know, if you can cope with that. Okay, what I want to say, guys, this is a very, very summarized version of what you can do from the federation services. Okay, we are now forcing all the users to get the token from your local domain controller. Again, very nice for companies not happy in kind of synchronized users and passwords. Okay, guys, this is one thing, okay, pass-through authentication. If I go back to this presentation, to this screenshot, we have the pass-through authentication, and then there is a link below, enable single sign-on. If you tick that option, okay, very nice. Basically, guys, we can have a simple single sign-on implemented as well without ADFS. The picture here maybe is a little bit confusing, but it's kind of the same story. If the user comes in the morning, logged on the local domain controller, provide the username and password and so on, next time when the user open up, I don't know, Outlook or something, basically the user doesn't need to type the username and password again because it's basically, it works on single sign-on. Please don't get too excited, guys. This is a kind of mini federation service version. Okay, I tested with Exchange Outlook, worked fine. I tested with with SharePoint, it worked fine as well, no problem at all. It didn't work with Skype for Business. And guys, when you are talking about apps, 30-party apps, I don't know, Salesforce, maybe, you know, SAP apps and stuff like that. And then most likely at the moment is not going to work. Okay, this is more for Microsoft stuff. It's a summarized version of the single sign-on for the Microsoft version only. But I would say, please take your time. And if you have a lab environment, okay, it would be nice. As I said, literally, it's just matter to go ahead and push the button and change the configuration. And it works really nice. Of course, if you have any reason to have the authentication happening from your local domain controller instead Azure AD, yeah, that's kind of, you know, is a summarized version of the synchronization. Okay, and guys, let's say when you run the wizard, using selecting the pass-through authentication and the enable single sign-on, and then of course from the Office 365, sorry, from the Azure AD, yeah, you will see those two features now implemented, and then you can benefit, okay, from there straight away. Oh, guys, sorry, I need to tell you something. Just a second, Liam. Would you be able in a few seconds just to paste the seminar evaluation for me there, please? I'm not sure where I put the link. Liam was smiling. Thanks.
Sorry, say that
Okay.
again.
Yeah, Liam, I'm not sure where is the seminar evaluation. Just a survey, if you could paste for me on the
Okay,
chat
yep.
box.
Give me one
Okay,
second.
thanks. Yeah, sorry guys about that. I got confused here. Guys, okay, just for us to finish. If you want to implement the seamless single sign-on, I kind of lied to you a little bit. There are two configurations to be done. Three, okay? Very simple, okay? First one is make sure you tick that box, okay? Enable the single sign-on, okay? And then, guys, there are two other bits and pieces you need to do. You need to change the site to zone assignment list. And then you need to add those two addresses. I'm not sure if it's readable from you. Otherwise, I will send my presentation. Okay, there is no problem at all. And then basically, you need to make sure all the computer join. Okay, they have those two things. And then there is the last one is yeah, under the allow updates to a status bar via script. Okay, you need to make sure that thing is enabled as well. Of course, if you just go through Bing, okay, I would say, and search for seamless single sign-on, you will get a step-by-step, and then part of the step-by-step is, you know, run the wizard and then enable those two little things. And guys, that's it. Yeah, this is just a screenshot, okay, I took from my implementation last year at some stage, okay, where I was kind of testing. And then, as you can see, this was a Kerberos ticket, okay, request. It means I try to log on my Azure AD, and then my Azure AD had to talk to my local domain controller to request a Kerberos authentication. And then, yeah, that's happened for the user called april@adatum.com. And, you know, just a quick test, okay, I did for the implementation. Pretty much, you know, very simple. Okay, guys, that's it pretty much. Sorry about that, we are a little bit late. And if you have any question, you know, you could send by email or if you want to type for me, okay, there is no problem at all. And finally, before, okay, we go, of course, Azure is something, you know, you don't learn in a couple of weeks or a couple of months. Okay, it's a kind of, you know, big monster thing to learn. If you are enthusiastic enough and you are looking for a new big challenge, that would be the official courses available today. Okay, if you want to attend kind of official courses and do the certification, the first one is the Azure Fundamentals. Okay, it's only 2 days. If you have been working bits and pieces with Azure, you could skip that one. And then the third one is for guys like me. Okay, I didn't tell you at the beginning, I'm not a developer and I'm not a SQL Server guy. And then, you know, it's like implementing. If you are a developer, okay, and then you could do the second one. And then, of course, the third one is new enough. It was released back in January. Is, of course, a top class one to do the whole architecting. Okay, guys, as you can see, if you need to go on the chat box, there is a link. Hopefully, everybody is kind of happy with information. Hopefully, you managed to learn something new. And if you could give us 2 more minutes just to go ahead and fill out that little form, okay, that would be brilliant. And if you have any suggestions of other seminars, okay, kind of, you know, quick seminars, 1 hour, 1 hour and a half, we could run about. I've been working quite a lot now on Azure migration, you know, sorry, VMware migration to Azure, Hyper-V and security and, you know, bits and pieces. If you have any suggestions, you know, that would be great if you want to share with us. We could come up and, you know, organize some more of these seminars. Guys, that's it pretty much for me. If you have any question, okay, but please go ahead and just type in for me. Otherwise, if you want to disconnect, I hope to catch up with you at some stage again. Okay, and all the best and thanks for your time.